on us for purposes either benign or malevolent. It's not the first time astrophysicist Avi Loeb has suggested the object has alien origins. He came on this show to say so a while back, even saying the object could be on a mission to release, quote, mini probes that could invade Earth. And Avi Loeb joins us now. He's the head of the Galileo Project, director of Harvard University's Institute for Theory and Computation, also the best-selling author of the book Extraterrestrial. Okay, why are we just now figuring out this thing is as big as it is? Why were we wrong in the estimates of its size?
Thanks for having me. Well, we know that the object is losing mass because we see a cloud of gas around it that is a result of its warming up as it gets close to the sun, but it doesn't change its path. There is no push that is visible on the trajectory of the object, and that means that it's very massive, at least 1,000 times more massive than the previous one, which was a comet, Borisov, discovered in 2019. Not only that it's so massive, much more than the previous one, but there is also not enough rocky material in interstellar space to deliver such a giant rock into the inner solar system over the past decade.
Well, explain that. Explain that, Avi. Like, so what do you mean there's not enough rock? What do you mean? Does this mean you don't, this is even further reason for you to think this isn't a natural object?
Well, yes, because there is limited reservoir of rocky material per unit volume in interstellar space. And even if you package all of it in objects of this size or bigger, then there is just not enough number of objects to deliver them at random once per decade to the inner solar system. So that's another issue. And the trajectory of this object is aligned with the planets around the sun, the plane of the planets. And on the one hand, you know, that's extremely rare, one in 500 chance. But on the other hand, it offers us an opportunity to observe it. And indeed, by the end of this week, it will come within 29 million kilometers from Mars. And there are several orbiters there that were deposited there by NASA, by the European Space Agency, by the Chinese Space Agency. And we will get much more information about it. In particular, we can get an image with a 30-kilometer pixel size. So we can then look at the brightest pixel and infer how big is the object.
So if you think the chances are getting slimmer and slimmer that it's a man-made object, meteor, what is it?
Well, there are some other anomalies. You know, during July and August, there was some glow in front of the object towards the sun, 10 times longer than it is wide. We don't see that often in comets. Usually the glow is behind, trailing the object away from the sun.
What does that tell you then?
Well, we don't know. You see, that is work in progress, and we just need more data. My point is simple. You know, any intelligence agency knows that they need to make a contingency plan for black swan events that are rare, unlikely, but could make a huge difference. We should do the same for interstellar objects.
All right.
Be aware of the possibility that it could represent alien tech.
Okay, anytime I hear black swan event and alien tech and interstellar objects, you're giving me, it's nightmare fuel. Avi Loeb, I'm sure we'll have you back. Thank you so much. Really appreciate it.
Thanks for having me.
阿维勒布提出了这样一个大胆的新理论，正如他在最近一篇新博客文章中所提出的，目前正在太阳系中巡航的星际物体 Cygnus 可能早在1977年就发出了这个信号。为什么阿维勒布这么讲？为了解这个问题，我们把时间拨回到1977年的夏天，美国俄亥俄州一台昵称大耳朵的射电望远镜像在安静夜里忽然听见门外一声短促的敲门，他捕捉到了一束异常强而且极窄带的无线电信号，那种像钉子一样窄的特征往往更像人工调制而不是自然噪声，于是一个名字诞生了，哇信号。为什么叫这个名？因为当时负责值守的天文学家杰里埃曼在打印纸上看到那段明显凸起的信号峰值，忍不住用红笔圈了一下，写了个哇。 一笔成了半个世纪的话题。此后近半个世纪，再也没有人听到过他的回声。他从哪里来？为什么只持续了72秒？就像有人隔着宇宙走廊，匆匆按了一下门铃。没等你开门，人就不见了。时间快进到今天。这位喜欢直球提问的哈佛天文学家阿维勒布抛出了一个大胆的新想法，那道哇信号会不会来自一个正在我们太阳系里路过的星际访客 3ILS 先给出当年的哇信号的天上门牌号，哇信号的天空坐标大致是赤经19时25分，也就是291度，赤纬约零下27度。而如果把 3ILS 的位置倒推到1977年8月12日，他当时大概在赤经19时40分，赤纬零下19度。两个方向不完全重合，但角距并不算大。一个方向差不多4度，另一个差不多8度。按统计学粗略算一算，天球上随便挑两块区域能对到这种程度，概率大概也就 0.6%。不常见，但也谈不上天选之合。还有一个背景细节值得说清楚。3ILS 没显出明显的非引力加速度，比如彗星那种喷气导致的轨迹偏差，少了这类不确定性，轨道反推会更靠谱。这也是为什么研究者敢拿这组坐标去和哇信号做对比。如果我们把假设往前推一步，假设哇信号真来自 3ILS， 那么一个现实问题马上出现，这么远它得用多大的功放才能让地球听见？观测记录显示，当年的信号强度在54到212个詹斯基的量级，带宽大约10000赫兹。把接收端的声音大小折算回发射端的嗓门，在600个天文单位的距离上，需要的原功率大概在 0.5 到2吉瓦之间。这个量级是什么概念？差不多就是一道数座核反应堆在那头同时开工，对着地球喊话。听上去很惊心动魄，是吧？但我们也得稳一稳。到目前为止，没有任何射电望远镜发布过针对 3ILS 的系统性射电观测数据。勒布因此呼吁同行优先去对频，尤其是在氢原子1420兆赫，也就是所谓氢的超精细谱线附近，仔细搜寻有没有窄带发射。简单说，就是先到最可能的频道去听听看。他还主张别挑设备，能上的都上，地面的也好，在轨的也行，只要能听射电能做光谱的，把 3ILS 排进观测清单，尽快补完盲区数据。因为只有数据上来，这个猜想才有机会从大胆走向可检验。当然哇信号的解释绝不止这一条路径。近些年波多黎各大学阿雷西博分校的行星宜居性实验室就把历史数据又翻出来精修了一遍。在阿雷西博哇项目里，他们尽量校正当年的设备特性和背景噪声，给出到目前为止最精确的一版参数刻画。阶段性的结论偏向自然天体物理起源，也就是说更像自然现象而不是外星智慧文明的铁证。但他们也强调，这不是盖棺定论，而是重新给我们画了一张更清晰的地图。下一步该去哪里找证据，该如何排除，路径更明确了。团队还立下目标，在2027年，也就是哇信号50周年之前，尽量把大耳朵望远镜的相关数据整理完公开掉，方便全球研究者交叉验证。回到 3ILS 本身，它是人类望远镜记录到的第三个星际来客，自今年7月被发现以来，一直是镁光灯下的主角。勒布之所以格外关照它，除了那组可疑的天区重合，还因为它身上有几处不太像路人的地方，疑似非典型的化学特征，在火星木星轨道附近的不寻常路径以及不小的体量。把这些碎片拼起来，它才会提出它会不会是某种外星工程的遗物。说到这儿，必须强调一句，这仍然是个牵强但有意思的理论。想从脑洞变成科学，我们需要大量可复现的观测证据。科学的好就好在 欢迎大胆设想，更要求小心求证。勒布的视角还不仅限于有没有外星技术这一个问号。他进一步提醒，星级物体并不都是温顺的房客，我们应当准备黑天鹅式的应急预案，低概率但高影响，就像古希腊的特洛伊木马，外表寻常，内里不一定简单。为了尽可能掌握主动权，他提出两条技术路线，一条是远距沟通，通过无线电或激光通信发出标准化信息，另一条是近距取证，用拦截器在他们的路径上近距离遭遇，带回第一手的材料与数据。最后是一个姿态问题，谦卑。人类的知识建立在地球经验之上，而我们未来可能遇到的对话对象很可能带着完全不同的物理知觉与工程范式，到那时沟通难度可能就像一只蚂蚁从地缝里看见一位骑车人，你能感知到他的存在，却很难理解他为何而来，要去何方。总结一下，哇，信号仍是未解之谜。三 IPS 的关联是一条值得检验的线索，不是结论。接下来最重要的是把听诊器架起来，集中火力在关键频段，动用地面与太空望远镜，给这位星际来客做一次全方位体检。无论答案指向自然还是文明，只要我们把证据链补齐，这段半个世纪的悬念就有机会迎来水落石出的一天。